Our next notable speaker is a senior product marketing manager at GitLab. She focuses on best practices for end-to-end DevOps, continuous delivery, and compliance with major enterprises. Prior to GitLab, she had extensive working experience at VMware and Micro Focus. She also comes with a strong product management, marketing, and consulting background in high tech and telecom. In our power-packed session today, she's going to uncover on how GitLab enables earlier collaboration and shortens feedback loops, what auto DevOps can do to help simplify CI/CD setup and execution, and how GitLab helps you shift security all the way left. Ladies and gentlemen, we are very ecstatic to bring to you Ms. Soumya Upadhyay, coming to your screens right now.
Why seeing is believing. I'll tell you what we do and briefly also show you how we do it. If you need a deep dive, please visit our booth and a deep dive workshop that we will be conducting later during the day regarding GitLab. My name is Soumya Upadhyaya, and I'm a senior product marketing manager here at GitLab. I'm based out of Bangalore, and I've been with GitLab for close to 2 years now. And I've worked remote even before we all became remote since 2020. Outside of work, I like to work out, binge watch, and also pursue small projects that interest me on a regular basis. The latest being painting the entryway to my house. And I also change my hairstyles quite frequently, apparently, because I don't look anything like the image that I have shown right now. So why are we here today? I'll brief you on what we are seeing from customers that has motivated us to do the work that we do. I'll also talk about the GitLab flow and how using GitLab can help you improve collaboration, automate pretty much everything in your software development lifecycle, and bring in security into your workflow. We believe it is SecDevOps, as security should not be an afterthought, but rather security by design, as the repercussions of skipping security are way too much these days. So does this ecosystem look familiar to you? Is this how your software delivery landscape looks? And it's possibly the situation in your organization. Many organizations that we have spoken to have adopted DevOps on a need basis, based on very specific problems that they wanted to solve. So anytime they have a problem, they bring in a tool to solve that problem. Have a code review problem, bring in a tool to solve code review problems. You have an automation issue, you bring in a tool to fix that automation issue. Over time, this landscape has evolved into a Frankenstein ecosystem, which requires many people to create, manage, maintain the integrations itself. The goal of DevOps originally was to break down these silos so that a lot of the teams, like the developers, security, operations, infrastructure, and so on, can collaborate with each other so that they can deliver a lot faster. But a toolchain like this just reinforces the silos that the organization was trying to break in the first place. Instead of various teams being able to collaborate together, these tools actually put them in different workspaces altogether. And this crisis is not really due to a lack of investment. As per an IDC study, organizations continue to spend a lot of money on DevOps software to aid with transformation. But most of this money is getting wasted in the wrong place. A lot of times it gets spent on logistics and on repeatable tasks, on putting together various tools together. And while it's definitely better than what it used to be, almost 90% of organizations that adopted DevOps in this manner have been disappointed with the results. This hit home really hard last year when almost everybody that we spoke to from an organization point of view had a mandate to cut costs and improve efficiency. And this kind of wastage was not really acceptable. So how does this manifest in your organization? You probably still have a lot of siloed teams in your organization in spite of adopting DevOps to remove the silos. You see limited collaboration, you see limited visibility across various projects and groups. You probably still lack the speed in spite of adopting DevOps, which was expected to automate and remove manual work, because your teams are still putting in a lot of time and effort in trying to make these various tools that they brought in to work together. So like I showed earlier, you probably still have tens of tools that you have to navigate throughout your software development lifecycle. These tools don't talk to each other. These tools lack end-to-end visibility, because of which it becomes very complex to move faster. And you're probably still delaying releases, or even worse, releasing code with security vulnerabilities, as your security issues were found too late. In fact, I was just in a roundtable earlier today, and this seems to be a very, very common issue. So what do we have to do about this? So Gartner recently published a guide on DevOps value stream delivery platforms, and their findings reinforced what we have been hearing from our customers as well. The first is that organizations are finding it extremely difficult to scale because they're using multiple point solutions. Because of this, their teams are struggling to reduce time to market, because many constraints, including lack of visibility in the overall workflow. So if you don't know what you need to fix, then you will not be able to fix it, right? Then teams are also finding it challenging to set up secure access as they transition into remote working styles. So Gartner recommended, and this report came out towards, I think, the end of last year, that adopting a value stream delivery platform, that is a single platform, will help to reduce the complexity of managing complex tool chains. And it will help you to scale your DevOps initiatives. You need to adopt platforms that provide visibility and traceability across your SDLC and not very specific parts of your SDLC. And this platform should also be cloud-based, because since everybody is now working remotely, you and we're collaborating across different time zones, across different geographies, you need a platform that supports this kind of working style. But we have to remember that there are a lot of players who tried to pull this off, but they tried it with various different tools that they tried to put together and sell as a solution. GitLab, on the other hand, was purpose-built to be a single application right from the beginning. And we are kind of expanding outwards, which I'll talk about in the next slide. Even today, the first thing I hear from people when I tell them I work at GitLab is, oh, you're a source code company. We've come a long way from being just a source code company. Yes, we started with Git. We then expanded to CI, continuous integration, continuous delivery, security, and pretty much all the stages of the DevOps loop. And since all of these are provided to our customers as a part of a single platform, our customers have been able to bust these silos significantly, because now we are able to cater to different people within the organization, be it your developers, your operations, infrastructure, product manager, quality assurance, designers, and so on. So all of them are working together, collaborating on a single platform. In addition, since it's a single platform, you can have a single conversation where everybody can participate. I'll talk about that in subsequent slides. You have a single data store, so you're not copying information around from one tool to the other, right? So you have the visibility, you have the traceability as well. You have a single permissions model to improve your security. Earlier today in the other discussion, somebody asked me about segregation of duties. You are able to enforce segregation of duties for different people. You can assign approvers, you can assign reviewers, you can assign who can actually let a change be merged into the master and so on. And we have lifecycle analytics that helps you to understand bottlenecks, improve your cycle time as well. So truly, GitLab is not just Git. It is version control, it's collaboration, it's continuous integration, it is DevSecOps, it's continuous delivery, GitOps, all being offered as a part of a single application. So how do we do it? Let's talk a little bit about that. So GitLab caters to the end-to-end workflow from the idea to post-deployment monitoring. This opinionated workflow that we have at GitLab is designed to make sure that your teams are unified, is designed to automate pretty much everything that you can automate so that your teams can focus on the one thing that is most important, which is to deliver value to your customers a lot faster. So when you have an idea or need to make any change, you create an issue. And to make that change, you create a merge request. I'll talk about that, and you can also hear about that in the workshop later. You automate pretty much all tests, your unit tests, your system tests, functional tests, and your security tests as a part of your CI/CD pipeline. You can have the right approvers approve the changes so that no change goes unapproved into production. You can configure your infra for any change. You can deploy, you test, you comply, and then you repeat this whole cycle for every single change, even if it's a single line change. And the beauty of it is that the process remains the same, irrespective of the type of change that you're making, whether it's a security change, whether it's an infrastructure as a code change, or your application code. So throughout this presentation, I'll walk you through the aspects of this flow that will help you to improve collaboration, automate, as well as bring security into your software development lifecycle. So collaboration, let's talk about collaboration a little bit. So collaboration is key to developing great software and often underestimated in terms of value. Non-programmers often think that programmers are constantly tapping away at the keyboards to create code. In fact, we believe that software development is more of a discussion. It's more of a collaborative experience rather than a solitary one. Collaboration is what allows organizations to scale. It is what allows senior members of the teams to delegate without really losing control. It is what makes security teams scalable by shifting the security tasks left towards the developer. It is also what allows operations teams to scale. Because at the end of the day, the reality is this: there will always be more developers than there are security or operations or infrastructure folks in your organization. So in order for your entire organization to scale well, the load must be shared and must be delegated. So the first aspect of any change, anytime that we want to make a change, we have to define what the change is and why we want to make the change. And that is what we do it in an issue. So let's assume in this presentation that we're talking about a web application, which is called Tanuki Travel. And the change that we want to make is that we want to modify the homepage, right? So let's walk through how this is going to be set up. So first we open a GitLab issue, and an issue is where we define the relevant information, give context of what is the change we want to do. In this case, we want to modify the homepage, why we want to do it, who needs to be involved, how much time it's going to take to make the change, what are the requirements. So if you're adding a button, let's say for this page, where should the button be? What should the button look like? What's the text that goes into the button, and so on. So all the requirements that need to be defined will be defined in an issue. So this issue is like an invitation to a conversation, right? So an issue could be opened by anybody in the organization. So for the sake of this example, let's say that a product manager opens this issue saying that, hey, I want to make a change over here. As soon as this issue is done, then now the product manager needs to collaborate with various people of the team to make sure that the change can be moved forward, right? So they'll engage a designer to make sure that they understand the requirements of how the design needs to look like. They will engage with a developer to make sure that the developer understands what the requirements are, to scope the project, to understand how long it's going to take and which sprint it's going to be done in. And so on, right? So you can bring in various different teams that are relevant into this conversation starter. Now that we've invited all the stakeholders, right? So the designer could go back and come back with a design, which they will include in the issue. Now the change needs to be done, and that change is typically done by the developer in this case, right? So to make that change, we'll create a merge request. A merge request is where most of the collaboration happens. This is where the change related to that issue is actually made. This is where once the change has been made, the developer can invite reviewers. As soon as reviewers are invited, they can review the code. They can suggest any changes that are required. This is where also the results of automation are shown, which I'll talk about in a little bit. So the merge request makes it a lot easier to manage that discussion, right? And keep the flow of the conversation moving. So let's say that a developer needs to get it reviewed by two other developers, and they need to get it reviewed by a manager, and the manager needs to approve it before it needs to go into production, right? So all of these can be set up as rules in the merge request itself, where it says that, hey, this merge request requires at least two or at least three reviewers, and one of those reviewers should be a manager. One of those reviewers needs to be from a security team, and so on. So it's also a place where you can trace back the changes that have been made. So it brings in the concept of traceability, which is extremely important when it comes to compliance. What was the change that was made? Who made the change? Who are the approvers, and so on? So your compliance team actually will be very happy to look at the details over here, because it traces back the change all the way back to the requirement that started this change. So let's talk about a little bit about the reviews, right? So like I mentioned earlier, in the merge request itself, you can actually have the code reviews, or any type of review. So code changes and reviews can be done in the merge request. You can have different people review it and leave comments by individual lines for either the UI change or the code change, and so on. It is a central place also where, you know, all the suggestions that are given by the reviewers can be incorporated. And it is also the place where the automation test results are shown, which I'll talk about in a bit. So a quick note about the changes to be made as well. Most developers have a strong preference for using an IDE on their local machine. But we also have a web IDE, which can be used, which is lightweight, which can be used by people who are not so technical, right? It's especially useful when you have non-developers who are expected to make a change and are not comfortable with setting up a full-blown environment on their local system. So for example, our entire GitLab handbook is open for everyone in the company to edit, right? And non-developers, including people, let's say in legal or HR or marketing, can edit it. Obviously, a lot of these personas cannot set up or may not be comfortable to set up a full-blown environment on their local system. So a web IDE comes in very handy in such a case. And as you can see, we also support the dark mode. So now that we have spoken about collaboration, how you can collaborate with various people of various parts of the organization in an issue as well as a merge request, let's talk about automation, right? So what if all the tests can be automated as well, right? What if there was no need for you to write your pipeline, which actually helps to achieve this automation from scratch, but rather we put you on the road with the car and get you to drive where you want. Essentially, we'll be providing you with an easy to start template, which you can customize and extend as you go forward. And that's what we'll talk about in the next section on how you can achieve this automation. So in general, when you're thinking about automation, there are various different stages that you would want to automate, right? So there could be automatic code quality test, there could be automatic unit test, there could be automatic packaging and releasing, and so on, right? So we have created a unique predefined customizable template in the form of auto DevOps. And years of experience and best practices in GitLab have gone into creating this template itself. So you can automate pretty much everything, right? Like I said, whether it's your build or your code quality test, your quality test, your security test, all of this can be a part of this template, part of this pipeline that we provide as a template. Of course, the template is extensive, but it just scratches the surface. You can do a lot more to customize it to your specific needs. In fact, we have customers who have customized this to run it into thousands of lines of code or thousands of lines of pipeline code itself, customized pipeline code. So you can pretty much bring any script that you have into this CI/CD pipeline. So how do you do it? Right. So we can just configure this with a few clicks and let the automation start doing the hard work. All you have to do is have one checkbox, you set what your deployment strategy is, and you save the changes. You don't have to write any of your YAML. It's all based out of template. And of course, you can customize it and extend that YAML if you would like I mentioned. What we found is that getting to the first green pipeline is one of the hardest parts for customers. And that becomes a lot easy when you actually use a template like this. Here's our simple example of a very simple but customized auto DevOps template for the Tanuki Travel that I mentioned earlier. So once auto DevOps is configured, after the build phase of the pipeline finishes, auto DevOps takes over and kicks off the rest of what you see in the pipeline, which is illustrated from left to right. The screen is a bit small, but essentially what this pipeline has is automated tests for code quality, automated tests for license compliance, for static application security testing, dynamic application security testing, performance testing, functional testing, and so on. We have also added a few customized jobs over here, right, which may as well be specific scripts that you're using. So there are deployment testing script has been added over here. A functional test has been added. We also have two types of performance testing. One is a load testing, and then there is a browser performance testing. And then there is the dynamic application security testing, which we will talk about a little bit more later when we talk of security, because dynamic application security testing actually requires a running application to function well or to function at all. So these are aspects of your workflow that are unlikely to be easy to manage and located in a single place today, right? So today, if you have like different tools, each part of this probably was being done in a different tool, and then you're trying to piece it together by communicating with each other, right? So as you can see over here, this pipeline is part of the GitLab application itself, and it is part of the single application. So you don't need to piece anything together. They're all talking to each other as a part of a single data store itself. So this can be extremely useful and powerful in breaking down silos that you might have and having different teams work together. In this pipeline itself, as you can see, there is some QA aspect of it. There is some security aspect of it. There is unit test aspects of it, code quality, which is relevant for the developer. So different teams can work together towards a common goal. So now that the pipeline is done, now what? You can see the results for all of the tests that have been done in the merge request itself, right? So everything is connected. You don't have to context switch into another application or to see logs in another application. So you can see the results of the code quality tests you ran, security tests that you ran, license compliance tests. And what's the beauty of this is that as soon as a developer actually sees this, and this is done for every single commit that a developer does, right? If they need to action on it, they can do so immediately without really context switching, without really moving to a different platform, without context switching to a different tool to get the results. So everything is there in this merge request itself. So they can pretty much see everything and action on it immediately. So this results in a lot of productivity gains for the developers, right? Because the code has not yet left their desk. They can fix it right away before it actually goes to the next stage. And as we all know, a code that is fixed or issues that are fixed earlier in the cycle take lesser time to fix as well as are less expensive to fix. So to improve collaboration even further, right? So the pipeline actually creates what we call a review app. And this review app is a fully functional application that is deployed using Kubernetes so that your reviewers can review the changes in real time. So in this case, since we are talking about a web application, the change that we wanted to make was add in a box, which actually collects some information, or add in a button, for example. All the changes can be seen in the review app, right? This is not a staging environment. This is not a testing environment. This is still part of your CI/CD pipeline itself. So you can see the changes right away. So whoever is reviewing it can see the changes very easily, not just see it in code, but actually see it on an actual running application. So this is a big time saver. The developer in this case does not need to know Kubernetes, or the reviewer does not need to know Kubernetes. It just uses Kubernetes to create this review app. And this is automated and integrated into your workflow itself. The other benefit of this review app is that the dynamic application security testing is run on this review app. So like I mentioned earlier, DAST requires a fully functional application to actually do the testing. And this review app serves exactly that. So that's a great transition to our next section, which is on security with a focus on DAST itself. So why are we talking about security, right? So we all know that security is extremely important these days. The number of attacks have been increasing. It is becoming a prerogative to include security as a part of your workflow itself, rather than have it towards the end of your workflow. And then towards the end, you finally find that, hey, you have 10,000 security vulnerabilities. Then it becomes like a project issue, right? So you either need to take a call that, hey, I'm going to delay my release and fix all of these 10,000 issues, security vulnerabilities, or I'm going to deploy this to production with the security vulnerabilities itself, which again is a big risk, because then there is the whole issue of brand and downtime and all that comes into play. The repercussions are significantly high, right? So it is important to have security well in the workflow of the developer itself, rather than pushing it and delaying it towards the end. And this is a challenge that we are seeing a lot of companies facing at the moment. So like I mentioned earlier, we have an end-to-end workflow where as soon as you start creating an issue, it goes through a workflow where you create a merge request, make the changes, run it through the test, then somebody reviews it, approves it, and then it goes into production, right? Security now becomes, bang in the center of this case. So here it's part of the CI/CD pipeline itself. This is extremely powerful because the developer can actually see the security vulnerabilities as a part of the merge request itself. They can fix the vulnerabilities while they're still working on the code without really waiting for the security team to come back to them and say that, hey, there are security vulnerabilities in your code, right? And they only are exposed to the vulnerabilities that their code has introduced, not to the 50,000 vulnerabilities that might already be in the code, right? So this becomes very iterative. This becomes very incremental for the developer to achieve as well. They can resolve the flaws that they have introduced in their code before it gets merged back into the main branch. So what are the types of security tests that we can run? So a whole lot. And we are expanding this significantly as well, because security is a priority for GitLab since last year already. So we can do static application testing, dynamic application testing, dependency scanning. We can detect secrets. We can detect if you're using open source or using software where there is a license compliance issue. We can do mobile scanning, vulnerability scanning and managing the vulnerabilities, container scanning. So we can also protect your cloud native environment. We can do fuzz testing, which kind of introduces unexpected and malformed data into your application to measure the response times and stability to to understand if there are unknown vulnerabilities, right? And we're adding to this every single month. So every scan type can find a little something different. And if you kind of put together all of these different scan types, we can actually pretty much catch almost all of the security vulnerabilities before the code actually goes to the next stage, thereby reducing the amount of effort that a security personnel needs to put in finding and fixing the vulnerabilities itself. This is again to repeat that, you know, you can include these scans as a part of your pipeline itself, and these scans will run with every single commit so as to detect the vulnerabilities earlier. So security needs to be embedded in the workflow and be robust, not just be integrated somewhere towards the end of your software development lifecycle. Once included in the pipeline, the results are shown in the merge request, and this is along with the other tests as well. So the SAST results are shown, the DAST results are shown as well, your license compliance results are shown as well, all within the CI/CD pipeline results itself. So the developer can action on these vulnerabilities that they have introduced immediately, and not the other 50,000 vulnerabilities that may already exist in the code. Now, MRs or merge requests are a great way for a developer to see what changes they have introduced and what security vulnerabilities they have introduced. But when we kind of step back a little bit and want to see a higher level view, right? Because security vulnerabilities can be introduced at any point of the development lifecycle. There can be many developers working on many different merge requests, and a developer might even choose to say that, hey, I don't think that a vulnerability needs to be fixed, right? But for a security person, they want to actually look at that vulnerability and then take a call on whether they want to get that fixed or not. So the security dashboard actually gives you this visibility. And since it is part of this single application, it gives you the visibility for across the SDLC. This allows your teams and your organization to make decisions about priority, so you can focus the remediation efforts on the most important vulnerabilities and the ones that have to be finished. Right? So instead of having to collate reports across various different merge requests of various different developers, it's all now in one place. We see, like I mentioned, we see that this is extremely useful for engineering managers and security operations people so that they can look at it from a criticality point of view and they can have it resolved immediately if required. In addition to shifting security left, we also shift security right to make sure that the application is safe in production, right? So we look for vulnerabilities in the running app as well, outside of the pipeline. So container network security and container host security will help you not only ensure that your application itself is free of vulnerabilities, but also your infrastructure around it, which is the Kubernetes cluster and containers, are not being exploited in production. So that protection is also available for the cloud native infrastructure. So to summarize the security aspect a little bit, because it's such an important part of the DevSecOps lifecycle now, it's not an additional step in your process, nor is it an additional tool that you need to introduce into your process, right? It needs to be woven into your DevOps lifecycle, thus allowing you to adapt your security testing and processes to your developers and not the other way around, right? So a lot of times we hear customers or organizations say that, hey, we have a security team, they have a set of tools, we want our developers to use some of those tools. The challenge with that, and those tools do really a great job, right? But the challenge with that is those tools are way too complex for a developer and they are not well integrated into a developer's workflow. So if you would like your developers to actually start looking at software development from a security lens, then it needs to be made a lot easier for them, right? And it needs to be part of their workflow itself, part of their life cycle. And that is what the GitLab security does. So Don't hear it from me. We have a lot of customers who are actually using GitLab. We have 30 million registered users of the product itself. We have 1 million plus paying users, over 100,000 organizations that are using GitLab for different use cases, right? So like I mentioned earlier, GitLab's not just Git. It does a variety of use cases, and that is also illustrated by users like yourself who have gone ahead and voted for us in the G2 crowd. So as you can see here, the use cases are being spanned across various areas. We have version control, we have cloud automation, cloud continuous integration, continuous delivery, code review, and pretty much every single area. And we've been identified as a front runner or a leader in that particular space. And it has been voted by the millions of users that are using GitLab at the moment. So to summarize, GitLab can help you collaborate a lot better across various parts of your software development lifecycle. We spoke about how we start from the requirements all the way until the code is deployed into production. It can help you eliminate manual tasks with automation. And it can also easily help you to shift security left and shift security right to make sure that your application, that is your running application, is protected as well, thereby reducing risk and increasing compliance as well. With that, I will end this presentation and happy to take any questions on the chat. Thank you so much.